Euro 2004.
Tonight we'll be meeting Jane Middlemiss and Bob Mortimer.
We'll be recreating a historic England...
And we'll be saying a big hello to Tony Adams.
Hello, I'm Tony Adams.
Yes, that was actually our sound man, Wall, because we've run out of people to say hello to.
God, I thought Tony had started drinking again for a second. Yeah. Anyway, first, a few things we've noticed from watching the tournament so far. It turns out that Jacques Santini is not the only French manager who has strange ideas about football.
It's early stage in the Premiership at the moment, and we play some big teams, good teams, and I think Tottenham, looked like a contender for the Champions League as well.
Good call.
Yeah, he stopped it where he said it. And the Swedes have gone out. At least that means that their manager, Tommy Söderberg, can go back to his old job as head of quality control at IKEA.
As a player, as a team, you love to be a winner. To be a winner.
And he'll also be able to get back to his favourite pastime.
And all the Liverpool fans who are overjoyed that Steven Gerrard is staying, this is just for you.
Steven Gerrard.
Stato.
Stato, how are you? Feel the love in the room.
So, what's in the news, Stato?
Well, following Erzmeyer's decision to disallow Sol Campbell's goal against Portugal, Asda are offering free eye tests to Swiss nationals on production of a Swiss passport.
Asda? Yeah. Do Asda do eye tests?
Apparently. Hmm. Well, an eye test at Asda is £10.
£10, but that's not that generous.
If you turn up with a Swiss passport, you actually get a free one.
Yeah, but the point is, surely the moment has come to call time on the myth that England are out of this tournament because of this man.
There's us.
The one not...
Yeah. Oh, come on, that's him developing the new referee's whistle, giant size. Yeah, the man responsible is living in England, but currently, according to this wedding card sent in by Stephen Liz Badley, he's working as a vicar.
You see that?
There he is. There's his beaky nose and his glasses stupid notes. So if you must send emails to someone complaining, don't send them to Erzmeyer, send them to this man's website.
Not really. That is on his website. I actually saw...
Is it not?
Just a true bit now. I saw some of the emails that were sent to Erzmeyer. And they were really horrible and disgusting. So, you know, I was ashamed to be English. There's no joke in that, I mean it.
No joke. The audience weren't sure, but there wasn't, was there?
No, there wasn't a joke.
No joke.
If you're going to carry the cross of St George, do it honour, that's what I say.
Do it honour?
Yeah. And now it's time for...
Gary Neville's The Nonsense and the Silly.
In this episode, Bobby Robson auditions for Home Alone.
Stato, have you got any news for us?
Well, this new novel has been published in paperback, and Scotland on Sunday call it a great novel, one that tells us about ourselves and how we came to be here.
Well, that's interesting, Stato, but what does that have to do with anything?
Well, look who wrote it.
Luther Blissett? What, the guy
who's... The Watford player.
Yeah. Well, the Watford player we've got here on a still.
Yeah.
Well, he's pleased about it.
So he wrote that novel, Luther Blissett?
Well, yes and no. Over the last few years, a group of Italian artists and anarchists have started to use the name of Luther Blissett as an alias to escape conventional identity.
Oh, lovely.
They do all sorts of things, write books, make records, create art, and some of them even do illegal pranks.
Do
people know about this? Does anyone know about this? Has anyone heard of this? It is actually true. We're not
making it up. This guy is overgelled.
Yeah.
You've heard of the Luther Blissett movement. What do you know about it?
Well, basically what Stato said.
Thank God. Thank God you're here.
Yeah.
To confirm
no, it is true, though.
It is true. Here is a CD which is released under the name Luther Vissi, because they do all sorts of things. And actually, it's getting out of hand at the moment. There was a riot recently at which apparently 10 Luther Blissits were arrested and charged with participation in a seditious rally. And apparently, when they got taken to court, all of them refused to give any other name but Luther Blissit. Right? They swore on the Bible they were Luther Blissit.
And these were on lampposts in Venice, right? These stickers. They're right at the bottom of lampposts. And when you bow down to read them, it says, "Bow down to Luther Blissit." He smells of dog's piss. Mm. Does that make sense?
But a few footballers have actually written books, and we've got a few here. This is Jimmy Greaves' book called The Ball Game, and interestingly, the striker in this, the hero, is called Jackie Groves, which is very good. And this is another one. This is a real book, Striker by Steve Bruce.
Great cover.
It's a great big dead footballer. And the hero of this is called Steve Barnes, and he plays for Mulchester United, right? And I just want to read you a bit of this. It's from page 31. "My car was in the place specially reserved for me as first-team coach. I drive a Jaguar XJ8, 3.2, the sports version. It's a very nice motor, 3.2-litre AJ V8 all-alloy engine. Classic colour interior theme, fluted leather seats, contrast colour keyed fascia, figured walnut veneer. As good a motor as you could hope to drive."
That's a novel, not a handbook, isn't it? This is Gary Lineker's novel, All in the Game. Again, all genuine. And he plays a character called Darren, who plays for Barcelona. Good idea. Mm. It said, "Darren's hand snaked out and copped Claire's right breast through her shirt, stroking it gently, almost as if he was collecting peanuts from a dish."
Are you collecting peanuts from a dish?
I wonder if Claire's breasts had got 13 different types of piss on them.
I'm caught by this novel. On page 52, he says, "I locked the car with central locking. The XJ8 has a good security system with ultrasonic intrusion sensing, radio frequency remote control, and engine immobiliser. All necessary, this is a desirable motor."
Is he on a deal with Jaguar, Steve Bruce? And this is Karen Brady's book. Karen Brady is the managing director of Birmingham City. And this is about a woman who's a managing director of a football club, and she lives a very glamorous life. She goes to a film premiere. And it says here, her escort reappeared moments later, nodding enthusiastically at whatever it was that Jerry Hall was saying, and then popped up somewhere else, wearing an expression of concern, prompted by something Phil Collins was sharing with him. Peanuts, maybe.
Yeah, possibly. And right at the end, there's a very dramatic moment in this. It's essentially a crime novel. I just want to read the last bit, page 78. "A police patrol car, the kind used by traffic control, cruised by. The driver craned his neck to get a view of the Jag." Why not? It's an attractive motor. Oh, dear.
All true.
All true. All in there. And now, let's get on. It's time for a brand new series.
How did Stanley Matthews get here? How did Stan? How did Stanley Matthews
get here? May never find out.
And okay. Now it's time for another in our series.
Gary Devils, the nonsense and the silly.
Oh, sorry. In this episode, Bobby Robson auditions for Dad's Army.
Panic.
It, Dave?
It's Jay Middlemiss and Bob Mortimer.
Right. Jay Middlemiss.
Welcome.
Hello there. Thanks for having us.
That's all right. Thanks for coming. Yeah. So you've been watching the tournament, I presume?
I have, yes. Yeah. Yes, I hope Hewitt wins.
Yeah.
Only jokes. Of course I've watched it. I'm football man.
Yes. Well, one of the things we've noticed about Euro 2004, if I could bring you round to it, is that they've done this thing now that they always bring kids out onto the pitch during the lineup.
Yes.
Now, we as old curmudgeons are not sure about that. We think that's bad and it ruins the classic lineup. What do you think?
Well, it would be all right if they had to keep all of the kids throughout the match.
Yes.
No, it wouldn't. I'd prefer they came out with puppies.
They'd have been all right with Beckham. I think a small child could have kept up with Beckham during the political game.
I think it's just what they did with all the kids that had shrunk, you know.
That are drunk?
Shrunk.
All the kids in the trunk.
No, how do you have shrunk the shrinking kits? I don't know.
Drunk children.
No, the kits shrunk, and so they thought, let's put them on some kids.
See.
They're not drunk.
Didn't really happen. Puppies would be better.
Puppies would be good, actually.
No, they'd spoil it, though. Why have kids? They're Portuguese kids, aren't they? They're all Portuguese, so they're marching on with Denmark and stuff like that.
Oh, they're not actually from the countries they're with.
No, they don't think they import them.
What
did that to come over with their minders and all sorts of stuff? Parents, I think is the phrase. Yeah.
You know they're called soccer escorts. Is that what they're called?
Soccer escorts.
I think that's what they're called.
Bruce used to drive one.
Yeah.
Yeah. They have to pay. Do they pay for this? I don't know. They pay at Chelsea.
I don't know. They pay at Chelsea.
Do they pay for fancy football?
Kids, we don't bring on kids, do we?
Yeah,
we have any kids here. Yeah.
Well, we might bring some.
You could have little mascots at the front here.
But we don't. Yeah. If I see more than three kids together in a crowd, I always think nits.
You can see
the footballers already starting.
Perhaps if they just came on with fridge magnets, that would be enough, you know what I mean?
I agree with that.
Would be enough.
And also, there's this weird tradition, I don't know if you know this, that when you bring kids onto the pitch, the pennant you always have to give to the campest child.
The pennant? It's funny how you can tell at a very early age.
Isn't it?
You can. Yeah.
Well, was it like that with you, Deb?
Very, very like that. Yeah. I can tell.
That incessant whispering by the neighbours.
Do you remember those two terrible winters we had?
I do remember them. Yes.
Mike and Bernie. Oh,
Jeff Winters.
The other thing that's been very noticeable at this tournament is the big flag.
Yeah, we've seen very, very big flags. Look,
it's a mystery, the big flag.
Look, there's a big-ish flag, but look at that flag!
Oh, it's a whopper.
Wow.
Now, what we were wondering is, how does that get there from Croatia? I mean, they hardly have planes in Croatia.
They just wrap it round a really big chef.
What do you think?
No, I don't really.
But how do they get it? How do you fold that up?
It's a bloody big bit of cloth.
Would you be able to pack that? Women are better at packing than men.
Would it be a big suitcase, and where would you put your shoes?
What about the excess baggage on that?
Also, how do they know who's going to hold it at the bottom, and how does it all happen?
Well, this is what we want to know.
Yeah.
That's the most intriguing thing.
Imagine trying to make a flag that big. You get like lots of sheets. Where do you get that piece of material from?
Where do you get red sheets?
Where do you get the motivation? That's the thing.
Yeah.
Is there anyone here that's ever taken a big flag to a football match? I knew it.
Yeah.
I think the clubs make those and just disperse them to suggest we've got clever, inventive.
I think it's just to discourage toupee wearers in the crowd, you know.
Yeah, because they'll come off.
They will come off. I tell you, they have come off.
But talking about things that the crowd do, I mean, again, I don't want to come across as sour old people, but we don't really like the Mexican wave either, because we just think it always happens when the game is very dull.
Do you know, if you could harness the energy created by a Mexican wave, you'd be a scientist. It's nice when they peter out, though, isn't it?
I like that bit. When they peter out. Yeah.
But they're thoroughly enjoying themselves.
No, they're
thoroughly enjoying it. If you start one in here now, everyone will thoroughly enjoy.
No, I don't want them to do it.
I'd like them to do a really crap one.
No, I hate it.
Why?
It means that for a start, it means the match is boring. Usually, that's why they start doing it. No, they do it at the Albion quite a lot.
Don't you? But you refuse to get up.
I just sit. I won't do it. And they'll go, come on, Frank. And I just won't.
Are they comedy Birmingham people around?
I'd put it behind drugs in sport and possibly hooliganism.
Yeah. What is the worst thing to happen?
That's probably the worst thing in football.
Mm.
Yes. Mm. Is there anyone here who actually has ever started one?
Yeah. You've actually started one.
See?
Are you from Mexico?
No.
So tell, why don't you tell us that crazy anecdote?
I put my hands up and then everyone else did.
So you were fabulous. That's what I call a story. And if there was more stories like that on television, people would stay in more.
But did you say that you finished it as well?
No.
Oh, sorry. Because wouldn't that be something?
You're leading the witness.
Oh, that would be something.
She never said anything of the sort.
Oh, you're starting one on that sofa.
It can happen. No, I can't. Luckily, if there's a lot of bears attacking you, go like that, it can confuse them. And you get a Mexican wave in the woodland and off your trot and eat your picnic.
It will confuse a bear doing a Mexican wave.
And also, apparently, bears are attracted by the smell of menstruating women. Did you know that?
Really? Oh, get
they
lost.
Are.
Bears are.
They are.
Are they?
Apparently, you're not supposed to take a menstruating woman into the woods. Well, why would you?
No, come here, man, Frank.
Honestly. Jane, I haven't made that up. I was told that.
How
did
someone put one in front of one?
Yeah. Who found that out?
How did they find out? Well, they took several menstruating women into the woods.
And they set the bears free.
Yeah.
And they said, off you go.
And they sorted them out.
And that leads to that phrase, do bears menstruate in the woods?
Well, it's not. No, honestly, a cowboy told me that in Montana.
Oh, well, if a cowboy in Montana tells you.
Yes. He was carrying a small pennant.
Actually, before we go any further, actually, I think we have to have the second instalment of our new series.
How did Stanley Matthews get here? How did Stan?
Time it is, Diane. Do you know what time it is?
It's time for Phoenix from the Flames, isn't it?
Phoenix from the Flames, Phoenix from the Flames, Phoenix.
Luther, we're here to recreate a very historic event, your goal against Luxembourg in 1982, which was the first goal ever scored for England by a black player.
Yeah, I'm really proud of that.
For Robson, and for Woodcock, and Blissett surely this time. Left with the most open of goals, even then the touch wasn't sure, but it crept over the line almost apologetically.
I'm sorry, Luther, I didn't realise that Martin Tyler was so negative about your goal.
Well, I wonder what the co-commentator had to say about it.
I don't know what you're talking about, Martin. I think it's the best goal I've ever seen. I'm so happy that black players have made the mark in the English game. Overdue. And when I say Jew, I don't want anyone to think I'm being anti-Semitic. In fact, never a day goes by. And when I say Dago, I don't mean...
Ron, you can't come back on the telly.
Well, anyway, I actually scored a hat-trick in that game.
Blissett puts it in. Blissett's in the middle. It's the hat-trick.
And that's my greatest ever achievement.
Well, I don't know about that. But what about this? It's a great novel. Particularly like this bit. The coin of the kingdom of the mad dangles on my chest to remind me of the eternal oscillation of human fortunes.
No. Luther Blissett is an international neo-political movement of anarcho-syndicalists whose whole purpose is the deconstruction of the individual identity, as it says in their manifesto. Chiunque può essere Luther Blissett, semplicemente adottando il nome Luther Blissett. Their slogan is Essere Luther Blissett.
Right.
Shall we do my goal now?
All right then. Well, Frank, you be Luther Blissett. I'll be Luther Blissett. And you be Luther Blissett.
No, play Martin Tyler.
For Robson and for Woodcock. Blissett surely this time.
No, I'm Luther Blissett.
I'm Luther Blissett.
I'm Luther Blissett.
I am Luther Blissett.
Look, clear off the lot of you. I'm Luther Blissett. And for Woodcock. And it crept over the line almost apologetically.
Fair enough. You are Luther Blissett.
Oh, the coin of the kingdom of the mad dangles on my chest. Remind me of the eternal oscillation of human fortunes.
A sort of experimental avant-garde Phoenix from the Flames. Yeah. It's a good thing, I think.
Yeah. Is that the doorbell?
I think it is the doorbell. I'll get it.
That's all good, thank you.
It's Derek Mountfield. Derek, have you come as the Reverend Sven-Göran Eriksson?
No, I'm Luther Blissett.
You think we're on the run? We are the boys who will stop your little game. We are the boys who will make you think again. 'Cause who do you think you are kidding, Mr. Hitler? If you think old England's done. Mr. Brown goes up to town on the 821. But he comes home each evening and he's ready with his gun. So who do you think you are kidding, Mr. Hitler? If you think old England's done.